It is with joy that I answer the question just put to me. There really are, and I have observed this on a number of occasions, a rather large number of excellent people who, judging that the modern world is irrecoverable for any kind of good, close themselves up in their homes and merely try to lead their family lives and their spiritual lives without bothering with what we could call the Catholic cause as a whole, that is, the cause of the Holy Roman Catholic and Apostolic Church and that of Christian civilization. I have a word to say about the cause of Christian civilization, because it is easy to understand what is meant by the Catholic cause. It is the cause at stake when one fights to ensure that the Church has the proper conditions to develop its apostolate, and when one collaborates with the apostolate of the ecclesiastical hierarchy for the salvation of souls through the practice of virtue on earth, of which virtues the first is the love of God. In this light, the Catholic cause is well understood. Now, what is the cause of Christian civilization, and what is its link with the Catholic cause? What is a civilization? I am not going to dwell here on a doctrinal analysis of the many meanings of the word civilization. I will simply take an element common to all the meanings of the word civilization, and this element is the idea of a certain order of things considered as a whole, from its highest aspects on the religious-cultural level to its most trivial aspects on the purely material level. When this order of things is inspired by certain principles, it constitutes a civilization distinct from other civilizations modeled on different principles. Our Christian civilization is one modeled upon the great convictions, the great aspirations, the great hopes, that is, by the great moral norms that our Lord Jesus Christ brought to the earth, and of which the Catholic Church is the infallible mistress, the mother, guide, and the giver of life through the sacraments. Christian civilization creates the conditions for souls to know the Church better. To use an analogy that has the imperfections of all analogies, the Church is to Christian civilization more or less what the soul is to the body. The Church outside a civilization would be somewhat comparable to a soul without a body, and a civilization without the Church is frankly comparable to a body without a soul. The perfect order consists in the Church modeling a civilization through which she can do every good to men, that is, a temporal order that helps her do good to men, and on the other hand, a civilization that deserves to be called Christian to the degree that it provides the living conditions prescribed by Jesus Christ in their fullness. We have the Church. But since we no longer have Christian civilization, and even the Holy Catholic Church herself is grappling with the greatest internal crisis she has ever known in all the centuries of her existence, and also with a tremendous external crisis. Therefore, many people think they can, and even should, lock themselves up in their homes and carry on their lives with indifference, and that this is enough. Since the world did not amend, they expect the chastisement predicted in Fatima to come soon, and since the consecration to the Immaculate Heart of Mary was not made precisely according to the conditions asked by Our Lady at Fatima, they expect this chastisement to come. Until it comes, they are going to wait tranquilly at home. So it is difficult for them to understand the great effort the TFP makes to fight in public squares, in the newspapers, radio, and television, to oppose the adoption of types of civilization, even more gravely atheistic and pantheistic, in order to preserve the remnants of Christian civilization that exists throughout the world. Why do all this if everything is going to disappear in the tragic torrent of punishments that will invade the earth like a new flood, they think, and lead everything to the beginning of a new order of things? I think the question is understandable, but I also think that the TFP's answer to this question is understandable. And I will take up a few minutes of the attention of our friends who are gathered around this television screen to answer this question. First of all, I think one should consider that an extraordinarily beautiful passage from Scripture, from the Old Testament, can be applied to the church and Christian civilization. We owe them both the love that the Hebrews of the Old Testament had for the Temple of Jerusalem. They loved the Temple of Jerusalem. As the psalmist says, he loves the Temple of Jerusalem, but he loves not only the temple. But imagining that the temple were destroyed, he loves the stones that are left after its destruction. When these stones are pounded into dust, he loves the dust they have been ground into. I know very well that the church has not been destroyed, because she is immortal. But one would almost have the temptation to ask if the mysterious process of self-destruction in which she finds herself, that Paul VI mentioned with so much force of expression, if this process of self-destruction has not already reached its end. It cannot reach its end completely, because the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. But one could almost ask this question, which certainly could be asked about Christian civilization. It has been destroyed. Of it there remains neither the building nor the stones, merely the dust. But do we not regard this dust as the ancient Jews regarded the temple? Did they not love that dust, and did they not hope for the rebuilding of the temple? I speak of the Jews who came before our Lord Jesus Christ, not of the Jews pertinacious in error, in the sin of deicide, who want to rebuild the temple against the will of our Lord. I speak of the Jews who wanted to rebuild the temple when it was the true house of God, when it was the link between men and heaven. This is how we are. We want to recompose the dust to make stones, and with the stones rebuild the edifice. Someone might laugh, "You few, little will you achieve." I respond, "I know that.